Bona tarda a tothom. Encetem ja la recta final d'aquestes jornades que, no per ser molt llargues, són menys interessants. Jo crec que ha valgut molt la pena totes les discussions i les conclusions a què s'han arribat. I volem acabar amb una conferència del professor Pichler que ens ha de definir una mica, o ens ha d'ajudar a definir, quin és el full de ruta per construir la ciutadania europea. És a dir, per ser capaços d'orientar-nos cap als futurs reptes. En un moment que vivim pendents del futur i pendents de qualsevol aspecte de la nostra vida que ens doni una certa orientació. No? I jo crec que el professor Pichler ens donarà un cop de mà en això. Per tant, passo a presentar-lo sense més dilació al professor Johannes Pichler, Professor of European Legal Development at the University of Graz, Director of the Austrian Institute of Legal Policy in Salzburg. Thank you very much for coming. You have the floor.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, I have yesterday in the evening tried again and again to say, mis señores y señores, I gave it up, it didn't work out. So, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished members of the Barcelona European Citizens Initiative Conference, ladies and gentlemen, and first of all, dear initiators, a great day. There's just one concern. I feel totally overburdened from the expectations. We, as my part, we want to reflect on the future challenges in the EU and on the mechanisms of consolidation and, well, a bit much to me. I am partly a party. I am definitely siding with initiatives and with the ECI, so I'm not really a neutral observer. But anyway, we, I think, the United Citizens of Europe, have got with this ECI a tremendous chance by our new constitution. The Lisbon Treaty invites us, the European citizens, to reconquer our Europe. And Article 11 of the Union Treaty fanfares citizens. You can make this union to your union. So hooray, let us with the ECI finally go transnational. Let us make Europe as our Europe. And ladies and gentlemen, yes, it's true. The sovereign are we. We the citizens. And so we could really think that a new era has begun with the Union Treaty. But unfortunately, as is so often the case, there is a certain gap between a constitution and a constitution's reality. As we all know, also in our nation states. There is really a great risk that people get upset by just this gap of a soundy promise of a constitution and a bit different reality. So I am, on the one hand side, really eager to sing our European anthem. But on the other side, we must take care about not to make the gap too great. And so I think I start first a bit summarizing what I've heard here. To summarize once again the criticisms on the ECI's shape and state as is regulated for the time being. And unfortunately, the representative of the Commission is back in town. Why starting with the rather negative aspects? Ladies and gentlemen, firstly, to show that I am neither a dreamer nor a flash dancer or not. And the other one is simply a second reason to get off with it finally. It makes me depressed. I've witnessed for some hours, and it's really in all these debates on the ECI, a picture comes into my mind. We are like parents, just having had our wedding, committing that we will have five children, and since the whole first year of our marriage, do we debate on what could happen in the pregnancy in the first 6 weeks, what could happen in the next 2 months, and what could happen with the baby at all. And this is the wrong approach to me. But not to appear to be living on the moon, I would like to make a balance on the criticisms for a while, but then let us go on steadily and only face forwards. First of all, I agree on any criticism which was brought up here. There is not much investment done by the Union, and it's not only the Commission. We have some institutions. There's not much investment done to create awareness about the instrument itself. To make one or the other one advertisement on the local area is really, it's a nice gesture, but it makes no sense. I have not really heard a pompous, trumpeting statement from all the faces of the Union, the President of the European Council, the President of the Commission, the President of the Parliament. I haven't heard them. They tell us there is an ECI. People use it. And that was it. Then I agree that foreseen with this was a statement of Mark, I think, the maximum time of 12 months is of a fatal consequence, simply. And I agree on that. Then the admissibility restrictions are inappropriate. Well, the personal data requirements, as our colleague mentioned right now, are in most of the jurisdictions and member states so intrusive that private signature gatherers without an international reputation will certainly fail. They must fail inevitably. I would not give you my signature, my address, my passport number if I don't know whom you are, even if you are a nice guy. So this makes no help. And then there's another case that the literal overall conditions are seen to be benefiting only highly prominent organizations and excluding nearly all small initiatives. Then, to put the whole run of a political, democratic, social contribution onto private people, this is really a scandal. Sorry, I must say that this is a scandal, because if I would like to make an initiative on my nation state level, it is self-evident that the government has to support the process. It has to open any office of the communities that we can give our votes and give our signatures. So I have really no patience on that point to let everyone make its own tool. We've got from the Commission a tool, but as I have heard, this tool is not seen as the best one available. So most of the initiatives look for their own on the market, and this produces a lot of costs. The Austrian Parliament, in a very sensational hour, always when it runs against Brussels, of course, this is very easy, but they have committed to provoke the Union that they should have come up with one European tool officially run, publicly run under public liability and not under private liability. And I hope that the Austrian government, or the Austrian parliament, sorry, is influential enough to get it through. The next point is there are serious concerns, and it was part of your statement, there are serious concerns about the online open source tool regarding to liability implications and to security standards. Friends, community, initiators, some are here, I feel morally as well as by professional ethics obliged to underscore this warning. Keep your data stock, initiators, keep your data stock as secure as just possible, because if you should become reliable for any fault or negligence, this could lead to a private financial catastrophe. You could get sued under any of the 27 jurisdictions, and no one can forecast anything. Not any of my colleagues in the universities, nor in the Barreau, can make any perspective idea what it could be about. It could be really very shocking. Then there are criticisms that there is not sufficient support structure, there's no office which is consulting and so on. Well, for the formal procedural legal hurdles, do we have quite good information available? For example, the project and the brochure is stored out there of Tony Venables. It's a very good guy. I can also recommend the guide of my very good old friend Bruno Kaufmann. He has published several guides, and there's one from the European Economic and Social Committee, which you can download on the website of the EEC. Furthermore, right now, we, the ECAS project partners, including myself, plan to show up with an online tool helping to take and make the procedural garden pathways, which are at stake. It's true. So, ladies and gentlemen, I would really like to finish up with the criticisms now. I have made my bilance, which I'm obliged to do. But I am a legal historian, and now comes the turn. I am a legal historian. To me, a professor for legal history, to me it was last month that the citizens have thrown aristocratic judges and functions from the Areopag in Athens. It was last week to me that there was a French Revolution coming up with a declaration on human rights. It was yesterday that we've got the Rome treaties, and it was this morning at the airport in Graz when the history finished to me in a sensational moment when I have read that the Austrian Parliament has one-to-one implemented the fundamental human rights charter of the EU one-to-one as Austrian national constitutional law. So this is a moment which makes me really, really hope, and I think we should take the turn and from now on look on the other side of the coin. Of course, initiatives need support, but they need another kind of support as we have all, we are so stuck in the legal debate. I'm a lawyer, but I can't stand it any longer. What initiatives really need as support is a mental support. They need another climate. They need encouragement. There's a tremendous need of advice how to bring up a pan-European initiative, organization that it works. Last week, right after Tony, after we have had an interview, an online interview with one of the initiators in Vienna, 5 minutes after, I've got the latest news. An ad hoc committee fired the chairman. The board around the chairman fired the ad hoc committee. The ad hoc committee went to the authorities with an appeal, and so on. Ladies and gentlemen, can you imagine what happened? This initiative is blown up before it was ever on the runway. It's the end. So we should really enter the broader scenery of the ultimate and final needs, how to carry out European campaigns. And in front of any campaigning advice, we must talk with the initiatives about the hardcore challenges, not the legal ones. Do you remember the say, stupid, it's the money? Let me just disclose that several initiatives could not join our Salzburg conference for the only reason that they lacked resources to delegate just one representative. Then you know that initiatives of that size and that density will not even find out what the legal hindrances could have been about, let alone to resolve them. Without minimum resources in terms of altruistic co-combatants, plainly speaking also in terms of money, such initiatives have fallen from the wagon long before the wagon has pulled off from the station. To talk about this aspect, being consulted, about consultants, about lousy blood-sucking agencies which are underway, on business plans, campaigning plans, fundraising plans, investment plans. This should be the next turn of the debate. And I think we can, if we meet in Paris, we can talk about this circuit in Paris. Let us now move forward to the chances which the ECI could deserve or could have deserved to put the EU elephant on thin wire on the strong feet of a European citizenry. Let me therefore, representative, address a plea, a call to Brussels. And Tony Venables is my witness. It's the same message I have addressed in February 2009 in the first meeting. EU Commission, why don't you take your chance? We know the formula. There are three in the European history, three tandems underway. The first one was Senatus Populusque Romanus. The other one is the Council and the European Parliament. And I could imagine a third formula, the European Commission and the European citizens. And this could have been a chance, and the Commission has not taken it until now. But maybe we are, as I told you, a legal historian, we are at the beginning of a process. Maybe there's another Commission once which takes the chance, and we have in 2015 the first amendment, and this could be the opportunity that the Commission changes its mind. And within these years from now on to 2015, in these years, we, the observers, do have time enough ahead to resolutely argue the political outcomes on a political level, and we are committed to act as watchdogs, and we will observe cooperatively, nevertheless, persistently. And my institute has a task force now collecting all the shortcomings, all what are the factual external effects, what happens to initiatives, and so we make a balance and address it to the Commission in 2014, 1 year before. To keep on going a debate with the Commission how we could learn and how we could make things and turn it out better. And there is a very serious warning, and I would really invite you to address this to your body in Brussels. There are very serious warnings by experts, also coming from the Commission, like Jean-Claude Pierry in his wonderful great book on the Treaty of Lisbon, which he has edited together with a very unknown author. Her name is Angela Merkel. And in this book makes a serious warning that the political costs could become extreme and disproportionately high if the solemn guarantees in the Constitution should get fiddled away, underway, and if the participation of reality should delusion the public. And this is what Jesus has balanced right before. The higher the expectations are, the greater are the disadvantages, and it could really become counterproductive. So we must absolutely warn the responsibles in Brussels to keep an eye on that factor. So, and also, as we all know, in our community, Brussels plays a bit neutral, but there are some people on the way which are not really in favor of the ECI. And they are slowing down and slumping the process, not really hostile, but acting very professional. And I would give them a call. Beware, people. You may perhaps foolish one or the other, irritating. There are irritating initiatives on the way also, of course. But I think the Commission should be professional enough to handle this without any greater problem. And I think all these people are just a bit cooling down the enthusiasms. I would call them, you can't stop the evolutionary process. People all over the world are on the way to fight for the right of self-determination. And self-determination in the political meaning is participation. So this is just the other side of the coin of self-determination. And this is a process which can never get stopped. This is what Metternich got to learn, what Bismarck got to learn, and several others. We, the citizens, are in the long run the ones who will win. And this is why I would like to address the Brussels. Make appeasement with the citizens. Do it now. Side with all the initiative and the initiative Europeans. Brussels, we need brave heart, active citizens, more than all the mentioned thousands of whistleblowers and lobbyists. The future is inevitably on the citizens' side, as are the citizens on the open future side. And this was what the Lisbon Treaty clearly stressed. And we should not forget at any single moment to enshrine a participatory democracy principle into the European Constitution was not ever motivated by nice political sentimentality. The 2002 Convention on the Future of Europe wasn't made up of soft wimps. No, it was an assembly of very cool, experienced politicians. And they knew exactly what they did when they instrumentalized a participatory democracy principle. There was a clear calculation, and this calculation is openly and solemnly mentioned in the preamble of the Union Treaty. Without the citizens, the Union will blow up sooner or later. And in order to prevent this risk, participation rights were seen as the last remedy to possibly attract the Europeans to bolster up legitimacy. And to provide legitimacy, you know, is the final and exclusive competence of the citizens. It makes no sense when union actors and decision makers go about slapping each other's backs, mutually emphasizing to themselves that the executive body and the professional core in Brussels is fine and that things are going great, basically, and just the bloody ignorant citizens, people out there are ungrateful wretches. Brussels, stupid, out there, this is the sovereign. This is the sovereign. Of course, I hear my own profession, constitutional lawyers and theoreticians among the political scientists counter this argument. No, it's not the citizens. It is the member states that built the Union and not the European citizens. What might be legally and formally right can end up looking very silly when seen in the light of political acumen. And the great Europeans, like Mitterrand, like Helmut Kohl, like Jacques Delors, have always been aware of that and have therefore been backstage boosters in the call to go after the European citizens. It was their battle cry, Europe of the citizens, and we should take this call very seriously. And ladies and gentlemen, once again, sorry for this precautionary side note, but what initiatives need is orientation again and again and again on what the ECI was conceived as, what it was meant to be within the Union's political fundament. Otherwise, we will lose our track and we will get lost in peripheral phenomena. And we must see the ECI as the beginning of a new political structure. And I have a dream on the, as a legal historian, maybe it's 2100, but I can see at the end of this ECI process a European referendum. And then we have a serious right of the European suffering. And this is, and I am so hopefully, because we have heard by people like Jean-Claude Juncker, it's not nobody, by Angela Merkel, by Wolfgang Schäuble, they are frankly speaking about a European referendum. They are frankly speaking about a direct election of the president. One talks about the president of the European Council, the other one of a direct elected president of the European Commission. So we have a debate underway which could really be make a future. And this makes me now address a call to the initiatives. Initiators and initiatives, go upright. You can hold your heads really high. Save all your strength and energy for your specific concerns. Don't look back, not even on days like this one. Don't worry any longer about legal complications. This is our job, and I think in the long run we will handle it. You initiatives go for your goals, after your targets, because all that counts at the end of the day for a particular initiative is how numerous your audience is and how many signatories you have attracted. Believe me, therefore, the central concern of initiatives is campaigning, and campaigning some more and not worrying. Take my advice, ladies and gentlemen of initiatives. Try to affiliate with and to make friends with the other initiatives. Avoid any competitive approach. Replace it by a very modern collaborative approach. For very good reasons, initiatives may expect that people with a political mindset and a collaborative spirit will very curiously and positively look on the other issues of other initiatives which are at stake. So use any obtainable and available synergy. Nevertheless, keep in mind at any moment, be very realistic that you could, in the first run, it could happen that you fail your goal. But keep also in mind from the very beginning, at any moment, that if you fail, this is not at all the end of the day, not at all. Firstly, you can relaunch at any moment when you feel better replaced. Remember, there's not a single societal improvement that would not have been brought up by a minority. And remember that history improved solidly alongside the struggle of new ideas, and that development always was driven by single pioneers and spitfires. Secondly, whenever entering the political arena, and that is what you do actually. It is rugby time now, of course. Whenever you enter the arena, you face new conditions, but take it. Even Daniel in the Lions then got his chance. And keep in mind, even if you should have taken this 1 million criteria, the Commission is not at all obliged to hear. It's obliged to hear you. It is obliged to put you on a file. It is obliged to publicate the. Ladies and gentlemen, what are we talking about? This makes not a politically great deal. It isn't. So the Commission can overrule you at any moment with less than 1 million, more than 1 million. This instrument is agenda setting, but see it as a new track of a political process. And this is what you must get initiatives, and the Commission too. Thirdly, if you have failed, it's not the end of the day, as I said, because there is a holistic architecture in Article 11. We are always focusing solely on 11.4, but there is 11.3, this is the consultation procedure, and there's 11.2, which is the so-called vertical civil dialogue, and there's 11.1, which is the so-called horizontal civil dialogue. And I suppose, ladies and gentlemen, initiatives and initiators, if your movement has collected a real significant number, 600,000, 2 million, it's all the same to me, it's all the same. I'm a lawyer, but it's all the same. If you have collected a significant number, no commissioner and no DG will neglect your importance, and they truly will invite you for a constructive dialogue anyway. This is political acumen. The Commission is not stupid, not at all, believe me. Actually, there is a moral obligation to make you part of the civil dialogue under Article 11.2, even if you have failed. But even if you have not failed, what happens after? The party's over, let's go home, that was it. I think you should be prepared to be part of the political game from now on. And you should make your voice heard anyway, whether as a European citizen initiative or something else. Maybe in the so-called vertical civil dialogue. And I promise to work for that this moral obligation to accept initiatives as dialogue partners, I will really work for that this will become once a legal duty in the longer run. Finally, I can only push initiatives to unite with whomever you just can. The political game is only about building associations, organizations, alliances, groups, coalitions, and so on. And this is the way why I work so committedly in favor of Article 11 of the horizontal civil dialogue. Because, and Tony Venables works on the same issue with his Citizens House. We are really on the same track. Because why are we doing that? Only, ladies and gentlemen, only when all these initiatives and the split up civil society becomes one great European citizens society, fundamented on the constitutional basis of Article 11.1 in the UN Treaty. Only then can we talk about a European demos, and only a European demos can provide the UN with legitimacy. And this is what it's really the lack of. And this is the dignity of the ECI, and this is also the great achievement of initiators to contribute to the legitimacy of the UN and to make their union, we can always hear it's their union. It is the right way to make this their union to our union, and I think, isn't it worth to work for that? I have made my answer, and this is a clear yes. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Pilger, for your excellent conference. Penso que ja no cal res més afegir, estem sobre el temps. El senyor Pilger ens ha donat, jo crec que, ànim a continuar treballant i, a més, ho ha fet amb un debat que és molt complicat i sempre difícil de definir, com és el debat de la sobirania, no? De la ciutadania europea i la sobirania. Bé, en tot cas, com que estem molt justos de temps, jo demanaria, si us plau, al senyor Llorenç, director general de Cooperació, i el senyor Tony Venables de l'European Citizen Action Service que s'apropin a la taula i començaríem el breu acte de cloenda per donar per closes aquestes jornades.